Hello and welcome to the last video. Yes, we are down to the very end of our free-to-play marathon videos. Thank you for the one person who's watching this. Yes, you. I see you. I appreciate you. So in the interest of completionism, I wanted to talk about some other free-to-play games that I have played in the past that were not part of the F2P Marathon, and give you kind of an idea of some of those games. Note, I'm not going to really be talking about mobile games, so I'm not going to talk about Pokemon Go. I mean, yeah, sure, I have like 80-something friends, and, you know, I'm a pretty good trainer and everything. And I'm also not going to be talking about Star Wars Galaxy of Heroes. Technically, I'm the leader of a pretty solid guild, and, you know, they just released Jango Fett. Anyway, that's not important. I'm going to be sticking to games that have either, like, PC or console releases. DC Universe Online. Once upon a time, DC Universe Online was not a free game, but then it became a free-to-play game, and that's actually when I experienced it myself. You know, the concept is really neat. Being able to have, like, superheroes as an MMO is a really cool idea, and the fact that they were able to do it with licensed characters, like everybody from the DC Universe, is also really great. The problem is that the game itself suffers from, oh, what do I want to call it? I think I've called it this in the past. Is it MMO fatigue syndrome? I wanted to say that I mentioned something about it in the Elder Scrolls Online video, but I can't remember what I said.
Number 3, the MMO immersion problem. This is not really ESO's fault. This is a problem with the
Anyway, the general idea, you go and you see somebody and they say, hey, we have a mission and you have to go and beat these people up or recover this item or whatever. And then you go there and you do that and you get some XP and you grind that through. And eventually you raise a level and you get some better skills and you're super happy about that. And they go, okay, now you can battle more people. It's neat that you get to play between the heroes and the villains. You can choose your side and everything, but it's pretty much the same experience. Just from two different sides of the same thing. Go and beat these people. You gotta beat up Superman, or you gotta beat up the Joker. Pretty much the same basic experience, regardless of whether you're good guys, bad guys. And the problem that I had was that the servers were a bit problematic. I had gone on a pretty difficult raid, like, for my level. It was above my level. I got through the raid. Everything was going really well. I was like, oh, I got some sweet stuff out of this. And they announced that, oh, the servers are going to be shutting down in another, like, 15 minutes for maintenance. They went and shut down the servers, and it turned out that, like, all the progress I had made in the last half hour or so was just gone. Like, the raid never even happened. So that was pretty much the point where I put down DC Universe Online and never went back to it. Marvel Heroes Omega. Marvel Heroes Omega was actually a really neat game. You know, it had all of the Marvel licensed characters, so obviously I played Squirrel Girl. And it took like a top-down hack and slash, almost like a Diablo-style approach to gameplay. But if you consider how many character classes Diablo had, you know, like 7 or so, once you get all of the DLC characters, at least in Diablo 2. I don't know how many they're up to in Diablo 3. But if you consider that, the fact is, Omega had like 30 or 40 different characters. You just had so many options, and they all had unique skill sets and abilities as time goes on. Yeah, you can't play that game anymore. In fact, in anticipation of making this video, I re-downloaded it so I could make sure. And yeah, you can keep asking to play, and it just says servers can't connect right now. So it's not really known if we will ever see Omega come back, but they apparently decided to screw it. You could have a fairly competent free game that fails. Seems like that happens to the best free-to-play games in some cases. Now we get into the two games I played from Perfect World, so I'm gonna kind of talk about them at the same time. We have Star Trek Online and we have Neverwinter. They have similar qualities to them. They're both RPGs. They kind of exist in this massive multiplayer space, but Star Trek Online is like the sci-fi space setting, and Neverwinter is the Dungeons & Dragons classic fantasy setting. They do have the same general problem with, you know, going to a place, doing a thing, getting experience, going to another place, doing another thing. Neverwinter has this neat thing they do, though, where it almost, like I was talking about in Skyforge, it has kind of a Guild Wars thing where, you know, you go to a specific mission, and then you go on that mission by yourself. Or, I guess, with a party if you wanted to, but I'm basically a person trying to play a single-player game in a multiplayer setting. And you go on that mission, and you have some cinematics and things like that, so it feels a little bit more personal. And, you know, you get to roam the landscape and, you know, battle random monsters. So it feels a little bit like World of Warcraft. If you're looking for an MMO, and you want to try one, and you like fantasy settings, Neverwinter isn't a bad one. And, you know, since it's tied to D&D, you know, they usually have new releases and new stuff that comes along with every new iteration of material for D&D. Like, I know that they did a big one for Tomb of Annihilation when that came out. So, if you like D&D especially, you're probably gonna really like Neverwinter for that reason alone. Star Trek Online is a little bit different. You know, you get to choose ships, a faction that you're part of, you get to pick your team and go out on these ground missions and fire phasers at aliens and stuff, and you go into the conflicts between the different factions. And then there's also ship missions, where you're going around open space and battling other ships in ship-to-ship combat. The thing that's kind of jarring is that when you're on missions, they will switch between these two. It's pretty much immediate. Like, you're in a ship combat section, oh no, they've escaped to ground. Hit the button to go to ground mission, boom, and now, okay, I have my team and I'm on the ground. Okay, now I'm on the ground, apparently. The ship combat is fine. It's pretty nice that you can work in that three-dimensional space, and even though it's technically like turn-based combat, it's more like a KOTOR turn-based combat, where, you know, there are actions that stack, and you get to choose those actions over time, and there's cooldown timers, so you don't necessarily notice it as much. There are definitely some technical problems. There was a Borg ship that was, I think, kind of stuck in an asteroid. It didn't matter how much I fired at that ship. The ship isn't dying, but the ship can shoot at me. And so I kept trying to reload and start the mission over, and it just kept happening again and again. And that's pretty much when I stopped playing Star Trek Online. So I'd gotten the Enterprise level ship, and then I got a couple more than that. So I felt pretty baller. It's as far as you can be a baller in the Star Trek universe. Project Spark is sort of like a Roblox, but with a much better tool set. Some people said that it was the most powerful and richest set of tools for creating your own game that they had on the market at the time. And that's really not hard to believe, because you could make full three-dimensional worlds with some really nice models. So overall, wasn't really a bad product. It definitely looked and had better playability than Roblox. Even though you kind of ran into the same problem where you're playing other people's, you know, kind of work in progress on a game, and so it doesn't really function as well as you would hope. It's not really polished as an experience. Project Spark is actually shut down now. A couple years ago, Microsoft pretty much scrapped it, so you can't really play it anymore. But, you know, it was a nice attempt. I guess that's the reason why people are playing Roblox, because at least it's still up and operational. Onigiri. If I were to tell you that there was any, like, surprising free-to-play game out there that I did not expect much from, that actually turned out to be pretty good, that would be Onigiri. It's an anime-style game that's an RPG and has a lot of elements of, like, a classic Japanese RPG setting and style. But it's really an action RPG, y'all, and you go out in the field, and in real-time combat, you're fighting monsters, and there's a bunch of different kinds of weapons that you can use. You can choose different weapons over the course of time. You get to upgrade those, you upgrade your character, and in a really neat twist, I guess this is kind of Guild Wars-y, too, what you can do is you can go into different dungeons, and tackle them by yourself. And you get experience and rewards for doing so. The neat thing that they do, though, is that there's, like, three different difficulty settings for different level proficiencies. So as your level increases, you can try the harder modes and get better rewards for those same dungeons. But you're not restricted to just, like, a few dungeons. You know, they keep expanding the world and going out through it. The things that are a little annoying about it, though, is that between this, usually you'd see, like, fast travel points and stuff in the world. Those are pretty few and far between. So there's a lot of backtracking in the game, and some of it does feel very free-to-play, especially when you meet some of the other characters and you just see them kind of statically staring at you. There's also a lot of fetch quests, even in towns. You'll have townspeople that are going, "Can you find my 5 children? Shouldn't that be a you thing? Shouldn't you find your kids? No, just ask the first random stranger that comes by to find your kids." Yeah, all right. Strange stuff like that. But it's a pretty fun time while you're playing it. Dungeon Defenders 2. The original Dungeon Defenders from Trendy Entertainment was actually a paid game, and I actually did pay for it during the last console generation. When they made Dungeon Defenders 2, though, they decided to go with a free-to-play model. The neat thing is Trendy left a lot of the actual gameplay that was good about Dungeon Defenders in the game, and you start out being able to play the original 4 character classes. For people who aren't familiar with Dungeon Defenders, it's sort of like a tower defense game, but also an action RPG at the same time. You have your character, they're able to fight, they have upgradable skills and abilities, but they also have upgradable towers and defenses that you can also upgrade while you're in the actual battles themselves. You're protecting a crystal, or something of similar value, from a horde of monsters that are coming in your direction. And now you gotta set up your defenses and start slinging spells or smacking things with swords as fast as you can in order to prevent that thing from being destroyed. And it's a lot of fun, and the art style's really great. In Dungeon Defenders 2, they have a whole bunch of unlockable characters as well that really expand the amount of different kinds of playstyle that you can have, because they all have individual kinds of defenses and offensive powers. There are a few things that are kind of weird, like in the new game, the control setup's a little bit strange. I don't really know why. They could have just gone with the control scheme from the original game and everything would be hunky-dory, but for some reason Trendy really wants me to push the button on the analog stick. I don't know why. You had a system set up in the original Dungeon Defenders that did not require that, and you could have just kept that. But okay, fine. The original game, you could really play by yourself. You could play multiplayer, but you could play by yourself just fine and have a lot of fun with it. But there's such an insistence on the multiplayer experience that I swear I would go into some of these scenarios by myself. And I'm like, I am going to be by myself. It is a closed game. And before you know it, like, 2 or 3 other people would just show up in my game, who I have no idea who they are, and it's really annoying because in that system, you only have so much that you can build in any one level, and everything that you build takes up part of that quota, and so if other people are in your game and they start making defenses all their own, that takes away from the resources you have available to build stuff. And it's like, no, guys, you're gonna screw up my strategy here. So I didn't like that. I don't know if it was just something I was doing wrong in the settings or not, but I usually try really hard to not play with other people if I can avoid it. And they found their way in. Gwent. Gwent is a card game based on the game that you played in Witcher 3. And it was so popular, they said, hey, let's make a standalone game in kind of the Hearthstone or Magic the Gathering tradition. Gwent is a little bit different, though, because you have siege units, you have ranged units, and you have melee units. Different spells can affect different lines of defense. There's a lot of really interesting things with it. I liked it a lot as part of Witcher 3. When it was in Witcher 3, it was a really cool collectible card game you could play with the characters in the game. And that was pretty great. As far as minigames go, Gwent was excellent. I don't really know if I like it so much now that it's a standalone game, because, you know, they expanded a lot of those mechanics out, but I kind of liked the very simple, easy to understand mechanics of the original Gwent in Witcher 3. It was not too complicated to understand. And when they created it as its standalone game, they obviously had to give it more meat on the bones. But I don't know. I think maybe, you know, you overcomplicate a scenario enough. It loses its original luster. Plus, again, there's a lot of, like, loot box style stuff in the game. So that's just not fun. I like the fact that, like, in The Witcher 3, you got to battle other people, and if you won, you got, like, their special cards. That really felt like an accomplishment, but if you're just breaking open random card packs, I don't know. It doesn't feel as special or as earned as it did as a minigame. So I don't really know if it works as a standalone game, at least for me. Fallout Shelter. Now, Fallout Shelter did start as a mobile game, and then it became a console game. You can play it on consoles right now. Fallout Shelter, especially in the original version, was really cool. Being able to build your shelter out, raise new settlers in your vault, and raise their stats and give them better equipment and everything. There is just so much fun. I mean, Bethesda kind of sprung this on us at the same time they announced Fallout 4. And everyone was just, oh my god, all over the place. Because, hey, yeah, you're gonna get Fallout 4 in a few months, but hey, also, there's a mobile game we made, and you can play it right now for free. People lost their minds. And then they delivered on it. It had the same style, personality of the Fallout games, but it had some strategic elements. When they started to add on to the game, that was really where I found some problems. You would take out a team, and then you'd have to go to these buildings, these installations, and you'd go through each room and battle things, and it just felt like it took way too much time. It was more labor-intensive than I really wanted it to be. And I kind of liked Fallout Shelter in its original form. It didn't feel like it was going to sap too much of your time. It was some micromanagement stuff, being able to arrange stuff in your vault, and then you could just walk away for a little while, come back, see how things are doing. But when you actively have to sit there and just like, okay, next room, and you can't leave until the entire facility is cleared out to accomplish your mission, way too much tedious activity. So the base game of Fallout Shelter was a really great idea, but some of the expansion things that they put in later, it just doesn't really work for me. So I haven't played it in a while for just those reasons. Too much of a time sink when you get into those extra missions and stuff. Alright everybody, that concludes our retrospectus of free-to-play games. Have I missed anything? Is there a game that I did not mention, that I did not play in the free-to-play marathon, or that I mentioned in this video? If there are, well actually, please comment below. Is there a game that I should have played, or is there a really horrible F2P game that I should be aware of that does not even come close to a cat a stick, that has dug a new level of hell that I have not experienced? Are there really great ones that you want to tell me about? Please do. At some point, we may revisit the F2P landscape. For right now, though, I think I'm gonna go back to talking about some actual full release titles, because there's been some interesting ones, and I've gotten a chance to get my hands on some of them. So look forward to that on more episodes of Attempting to Play, and as always, good gaming. GG'ing, as it were. Is that a thing? Can I make that a thing? Probably not. Doesn't matter. So it feels a little bit like World of Warcraft. So it feels a little bit like World of Warcraft.